looks like we've had a power shortage or something. So we'll move on to the next item. And Martin Parr is one of Britain's leading photographers, known for his innovative colour work and for creating a new school of British documentary photography. We'll do it. We'll sort it out in a minute. His latest book, The Cost of Living, chronicles how the comfortable classes spend their time and money. But like some of his previous work, the latest photographs are controversial. Critics allege he's exploiting his subjects rather than making social commentary. He has already agreed to take two of the photographs out of his current exhibition after complaints from the people in them. We asked Martin Parr to explain how and why he developed his style.
These are photographs from my latest project, Cost of Living, the middle class spending their money and their leisure time. This looks quite different from most documentary photography in this country. If you look at the colour supplements and the magazines, if you look at photographic exhibitions, do you learn anything about living in the UK now, or does the work relate to what you perceive as part of your daily life? The answer is probably no. In fact, you would probably learn more about contemporary life by looking at the advertising rather than the editorial. One of the fundamental flaws in photography is that given the option, photographers will choose photo opportunities, the visual and the exotic, the carnival, the circus, or serious worthy subjects like mental hospitals and the homeless. My response has been to try and create photographs which depict daily life. All too often, nostalgia becomes a barrier preventing photographers from really documenting contemporary Britain. You know the sort of thing, a dirty old factory about to close, or perhaps a Hebridean crofter. Subjects full of traditional values which are gradually being eroded. I've fallen for nostalgia in the past, seduced by that sense of tradition and community I felt lacking in my home county's upbringing. I made a photographer's pilgrimage to a traditional millworking town, Hebden Bridge, in the 1970s, but I could never become part of what I was photographing, because my profession always rendered me an outsider. The other thing that occurred to me was how subjective photography was. Look at these two photographs from my bad weather project. Both taken at the same time, one with flash and one with a long exposure at night of a bandstand. The two photographs look and feel very different. Which one of them is telling the truth? Neither, because they're both different interpretations of the same scene. I also realized how photographers have neglected to document the ordinary. As a result, I went to the dullest places I could think of, car parks, motorway service stations, etc. But I was now convinced that black and white photography was inherently nostalgic and detached. It couldn't tell you what it was like to be somewhere. My inspiration for working in colour came from two sources, the work of American photographers Joel Meyerowitz and William Eggleston, and also my own collection of lurid colour postcards. I had just moved to Wallasey and found myself next to a run-down seaside resort called New Brighton. Like all resorts, it was full of families, ice creams, kids and dogs. It was gaudy, full of litter and atmosphere. I wanted to try and capture what it felt like to be there. Colour, with a bit of daylight flash, seemed the best way to convey this. Here's a photograph of a woman looking at me in a very uneasy way. She's about to say, "Why are you photographing me?" And this seemed to fit into the edginess that I found in the whole project. When this exhibition was shown in Merseyside, people said, "That's what it's really like." Down south, I was criticized for being voyeuristic and lacking in compassion. I maintain that all photographers use their subjects. The end justifies the means. And I had succeeded in highlighting wider issues like how the fabric of the nation is breaking down. Consumerism was the next aspect of British life that I looked at. Photography in supermarkets was a revelation. Here was something that everyone in the country did, as a pleasure or as a chore. It's a fundamental activity of late 20th century life that, to my knowledge, was virtually unphotographed and undocumented because it was so familiar. One day trip examined the phenomenon of coachloads of British shoppers invading the hypermarket near Boulogne for their Christmas supplies. The resulting photographs show the lengths that the British would go to get their bargains. The middle classes are the least photographed section of society. This is one motivation for the cost of living. Most photographers and their audiences are middle class, but they are escapists and want to focus their attention on other things. I'm middle class and have actually prospered under Mrs. Thatcher. This makes me feel slightly guilty, and surely this unease is a more revealing thing to explore than the usual trick of showing wealth and poverty together as a way of making social comment. So if I shop at Next, I photograph Next. I photograph things I don't particularly like, craft fairs and Morris dancers. I also photograph social events that I feel are pertinent to contemporary Britain, Conservative Party social functions, and the dinner party, the most middle-class social event of all. Back to nostalgia via the heritage industry, a somewhat instant nostalgia. For example, this newly thatched house in Milton Keynes, built in old English bricks. So by teasing out my own likes, dislikes, prejudices, and indeed vulnerabilities, I'm at the same time commenting on social change. These very personal and specific glimpses are a more revealing pointer to the underlying changes in British society.
Well, sorry again for those technical problems, and we'll have the Stone Roses on video later in the programme. But now, joining Martin Parr in the studio to discuss his work are Audrey Linkman, curator of the Documentary Photography Archive in Manchester, and Paul Watson, head of documentary films at BBC Elstree, who's best known for his Fly on the Wall series, The Family. Audrey, if I can come to you first. The photographs are being talked about in terms of some sort of archive, a social document to the way we live in Britain in the 80s. How accurate do you think they are?
Well, I think like any other body of material produced in this documentary manner, they are first and foremost the vision of the photographer. They are Martin Parr's vision of what he thinks life is like in 20th century Britain. And as such, they are as valid, I think, as any journalistic interpretation or anybody who keeps a diary.
So there's no pretense of neutrality about them, you don't think?
I wouldn't think so. My opinion would always be that the person behind the camera will have particular bias and interpretations.
We heard Martin say in his piece there that the photographer will always use his subject, but to a certain extent, the ends justify the means. Do you think that's true?
Well, that's a big question. I think Martin is a photographer who doesn't pretend to empathise with the subject in the way that a lot of photographers certainly do attempt to do. I don't think Martin does that. I don't think he claims that he does that. I think that what he does is he knows very exactly what he wants to say. That he goes into situations knowing what he wants to say, and he almost waits for his subjects to configurate and to do exactly the things that in his head he knows that's what he wants. I think that's legitimate.
Some of the images, as we've heard, have actually upset the people involved. Do you think it's acceptable to focus on an individual in that way, to make a wider point, however uncomfortable that image may be for the person in it and for the person looking at it?
Photography doesn't have an option, does it? It doesn't have an option. It has to focus on somebody. And I suppose reading the text that goes with the publication on this set of photographs, you realise how sneakily the journalists creep away. Somebody I met at a dinner party said, the photographer doesn't have an option. They have to photograph the concrete. And in this case, it's people. I think if Martin had refused to take the photographs out of the exhibition, that would be one thing. But I think to deprive photographers of the opportunity of taking the photographs they want, that's not right or proper, and we couldn't have that.
But he could well end up with an empty exhibition if he took...
Well, I doubt it. Too much of us have too much vanity.
Paul Watson, at the time of The Family, you came in for a similar bit of flack about being accused of exploiting the subject of your documentary. Do you have any sympathy with Martin's work?
I have enormous sympathy with Martin's work. I'm a great admirer of his work. We got a lot of criticism for The Family and for a number of documentaries. The maker will get the criticism. It's not necessarily from the subject, though. It's from those around the subject. The Wilkins family have always known who and what they are. It's those around them who feel they may have let the side down. In the fishing party, for instance, the fishing party group felt it was a fair enough representation of themselves until those around them explained to them that they'd let the side down, that they'd been stitched up. Now, you then get into the whole question of whether, as Audrey claims, you're going in with authorship in mind.
Well, I suppose the difference between those two films that you're talking about is that the family was about a working class family and the fishing party was about a upper class unit of people. Do you think that to a certain extent the way the audience brings its own prejudices and value judgments to bear on material in a quite different way when they're talking about a working class subject matter?
Well, the middle class are the most difficult people in the world to film or to photograph. They tend to agree, and I have to have a contract with them, unlike Martin, who can, in a sense, go in and steal the soul and dive away. I have to have some sort of contract with them. They tend to do it basically because they're going to politics, they're marketing something, or they want to be one up on the Joneses. Working class people tend to do it because they rarely get asked. And they're unrepresented, and personally I prefer to go and represent the unrepresented. But filming the middle class is extremely difficult, and there are lots and lots of traps that they will set for you.
Why, Martin, did you decide to focus on your own class and your own community, your own local community? In a way, is that, were you more gentle on them because you actually had to continue to live among them?
I don't think I was more gentle, but to come back to your original point, I decided to photograph the middle classes because I thought these are the least documented and least photographed section of society, and I thought it would be very interesting to try and catch up on this great silent majority. Who are these people that make up the silent majority? But I do agree with Paul, they are much more difficult to photograph. When I was photographing in New Brighton, which is predominantly a working class area, I didn't have anyone sort of come up to me and say, you can't take my photograph, while as I often would get that if I was in public events when photographing on the cost of living, people would come up to me and say, you can't photograph me, I know my rights. The irony is, of course, that their rights aren't actually there to stop me taking photographs. You can actually take photographs of people in public places and publish them. So they say they know their rights, but the irony is that in fact they don't. But they think that because they understand perhaps the power of photography or the power in the media, that they should have some input into that decision as to whether the work gets used.
So did you treat your middle class subjects any differently because you felt that they had the articulacy or whatever, the power or to answer back?
I don't think I treated the subject particularly differently. No, I don't think I did. It's just you did come across this problem of sometimes people saying, you know, I don't want to be photographed. And when you were going into, say, a private dinner party or into an antenatal class, I'd always ask everyone if they minded if I took photographs. But if you're in a public place, you just cannot do that. It's impossible if you're shooting at a garden party or a supermarket to actually go around and ask everyone.
But do you not get upset when you learn that you've upset someone?
I do. It's not my intention to upset people at all. But at the same time, I try and put in the photographs that I think constitute how I actually perceive the middle classes. And I have very mixed views about my contemporaries. I'm trying to show a downside as well as an upside. I'm actually trying to use photography as honestly as I possibly can. And I think that's something that most is not inherent in photography because it's much easier to hide behind a stereotype.
Audrey, as a viewer, did you respond to the middle class photographs in a different way from the New Brighton photographs? It's a very different body of work, really, isn't it?
Is it? I mean, it's the same photographer. And I think that Martin's work has Martin's style all over it. I don't think that, in effect, it's that dissimilar. Martin is distanced, quite clinical, I think. In his approach to things. I would agree with him. I don't think he has approached the middle classes differently. Say, for example, for the work that he did with us in Salford. I think that too is distance. I think too, on occasion, that is unkind, harsh judgment of the people. And I think that the same judgments appear in the current work?
Well, to me, the judgment on the middle class photographs seems a little less obviously harsh at first viewing. It was only when you really looked at them and sort of read them that you could appreciate some of the ironies and the juxtapositions. Paul, did you feel that the more recent work was as strong?
Yes, I do. I think, in fact, what you're saying is what every one of Martin's viewers say, and my viewers say. They're actually judging it from their own perspective.
Well, how could I judge it from anyone else's?
Well, exactly. And if you think that one is stronger than the other, then question yourself as to why. And all that we as documentarists can present is that which is there. Of course it's biased. You know, the cameraman, the sound recorders, they get everything in focus, they get everything in the sound, and I make a selection. And I'm sure that Martin takes many more pictures than he publishes. He makes a selection, the right ones, that come up with something that he recognizes in them. I'm not sure that Audrey's right that he goes out with a preconception of what he wants. Certainly,
do
as
you
a
go out with to prove a thesis rather than to just discover what you can?
Some of it is preconceptions, and some of it I actually discover as I go along. For example, when I was going to places like badminton horse trials, I noticed that the young girls there kept going like this all the time. That's something I didn't know until I saw it. As soon as I focused in on that, it was something I was looking for in the photograph. Mm. But not to make that the obvious point, it was just so it was worked in gently. The other thing, for example, I was looking for icons of the 80s, so a lot of the photographs would feature, say, things like designer knitwear. So whenever I saw designer knitwear in the street, I'd sort of immediately hone in on it and then find out what was actually happening afterwards and see if you could get a good photograph with designer knitwear in. But I wanted that to be in there because it struck me as being an important thing that, you know, was very fashionable and people were wearing in the 80s.
I must say, until I saw your work, I never realized before that it was possible to get angry about potpourri.
Well, I mean, the funny thing is, if you go and look at the shops that are in our shopping centers now, it's very difficult to actually buy anything useful. You know, if you want a 3-inch screw, it's impossible. You can get tons of potpourri and, you know, boxes of handmade chocolates and soap on the rope, all the things that are useless, you know, middle-class tat.
Do you think that, either of you, is a useful area of contemporary life to be documenting?
Yes.
Very much, very much. I think it says a great deal about the times we're living through.
Okay, well, thanks very much. Audrey Linkman, Paul Watson, right, and Martin Parr. Tomorrow on The Late Show, why the press was so eager to play down the risk of AIDS to heterosexuals. And with Dennis Potter's Black Eyes beginning next week, we take a critical look at his portrayal of women. Again, apologies for our technical problems tonight. We leave you with more from the Stone Roses, sadly on video. Good night.